Here is another illustration of the butterfly effect, this time using differential equations instead of iterated functions. So we'll go back to the example from the last unit, and this example will be a counterexample, a non-butterfly effect example. So Newton's law of cooling describes the temperature of a glass of beer or a glass of anything as it warms up to room temperature. So this is the equation, hopefully by now familiar. 20 is the room temperature, capital T is the temperature of the beverage. And a reminder that this is a differential equation, so rather than changing in steps and clicks, the temperature changes continually with time. And so a solution to this equation, which all the solutions I'll do will be from Euler's method or something similar on a computer, the solution to this equation is capital T of T, the temperature of the beer as a function of time. And as we've seen, we start with a temperature of 5. We see that the beer warms up. So it starts at 5, and it warms up quickly at first, then it's increasing less quickly, and it approaches the equilibrium value, which is stable or an attractor, at 20 degrees. So as we did with the logistic equation, we can think about this a little bit differently. We can think about using the equation to make predictions. So if I know the temperature of the beer now, I can use this equation to make a prediction for the temperature of the beer at a later time. And we might be slightly wrong in our initial temperature measurement, but that difference won't matter much. So let me sort of show that. Here is a made-up example. So we've got two curves. One I'm calling prediction, the other I'm calling reality. It doesn't really matter which is which, but I guess reality is the curve on the bottom. Maybe I should color that in red. These slides are available online, and they're in nice color there. I only had a black and white printer, hence the low-tech coloring. So red reality and black prediction. And maybe we make an error. Our thermometer isn't very good. We somehow overestimate, and we think the initial temperature is 2 instead of 5. Well, that's really not such a big deal. The temperature, the difference between prediction and reality starts not so big and actually gets smaller. And we know that even if I mismeasure the temperature, it's going to end up at 20 degrees. If I needed to be more accurate, say I needed to know exactly when the temperature got to be 15 for some reason, well, I could measure more accurately. And maybe I would need to modify the differential equation a little bit to take into account, I don't know, that maybe water condenses around the beer as it starts to warm and that changes the rate of cooling. So I might need to modify the equation a little bit. I might need to be more accurate in my initial conditions, but I'm getting closer and closer to reality, closer and closer to Laplace's demon, so that at least as far as beer warming up, the future can be like the present. We can predict the future with knowledge of the present. Okay, so this is the usual scientific gambit. We come up with an equation, we make some measurements, we can make predictions. The predictions aren't perfect, but they're good. We make the predictions better by tuning our equations and measuring more carefully. Okay. So let's do another example, and this is a famous example from the history of dynamical systems and chaos. These are called the Lorenz equations. And these are also differential equations. This time, three equations for the price of one. So there's an equation for x, an equation for y, an equation for z, and x, y, and z all depend on each other. So the rate of change of z depends on x, y, and z. The rate of change of x depends on y and x. Now, mathematically, these are a little different than the differential equations we studied in the last unit, and I'll talk more about those in subsequent units when we talk about strange attractors. But for now, we can think of these as just being a three-dimensional or sort of a tripled version of the differential equations we've been studying so far. And the origins of these, which I won't get into, but just as an historical note, they're put forth by Ed Lorenz in the 60s, MIT meteorologist, as a very, very simple model for atmospheric convection. not really a realistic model, just like the logistic equation isn't really a realistic model of population growth, but a very simple model designed to capture some features of convection. Okay, so just like before, we can solve these equations. Here we'll have to use a computer to do it, using Euler's method or something a little bit fancier. And when I do that for this equation, I get the following three functions. So this is an equation for three functions, x, y, and z. And they're each a smooth, continuous function of time. So this is time on this axis, and then x, y, and z. So the behavior is aperiodic, just like the behavior of the logistic equation when r equals 4 is aperiodic. So there is some sort of regularity to it, but if you look carefully, you'll see that these wiggles don't quite repeat. The x and y wiggles are similar. Z is doing something a little differently. It looks just almost like somebody scribbled, got really mad and scribbled like this with a pen. So there's definitely some cyclic behavior, but it's not exact. All right, so these are the solutions. They're aperiodic. Again, we'll talk more about this in subsequent units. The main point now is to have another picture to go along with our story about the butterfly effect. So let's do the same thing that we did before with Newton's law of cooling. Let's think about using Lorenz's equation to do predictions. And for simplicity, I'll just focus on the x solution. So we'll just be looking at this curve, not the y and z curves. Here's a picture that shows how we might use the Lorenz equations to think about making predictions. So I plotted here the solution, and just one of the solutions, x, not y and z, for two slightly different initial conditions, 15.1 and 15.0. And actually, this should be a minus here. There's a typo on this in the next couple slides, but the details don't matter. So the prediction will be the blue curve, and reality I'll draw in this sort of red, purple, maroon. The online versions have nice color, but again, I didn't have a color printer today. So the two curves, reality and prediction, are right on top of each other. There's not much of a difference between these, and the two curves agree right around until t equals 5. And at t equals 5, the red and the blue curves turn apart. The red curve, reality, diverges from the prediction right here. It makes a really sharp turn. And then the two curves continue on, and they're more or less uncorrelated. They're wiggling, each doing their own thing, and they seem completely unrelated to each other. So the small differences in initial conditions make a pretty big difference after 5 minutes or whatever these time units are. Suppose that we made a better measurement. Our model is correct. The reality and the model are both doing the Lorenz equations, following that rule. But the problem is that our initial condition is wrong. It's 15.1 when in reality it's 15.0. So let's try a much better initial condition. So we'll go from 15.1 to 15.0001. And reality is still 15. And now the blue and the maroon or red curves are right on top of each other, I don't know, until around 11. So reality and prediction match each other indistinguishably for 11 minutes or 11 time steps. And then again, reality takes a sharp turn away from the prediction. And then for the rest of the run, we have very different behaviors of the two curves. So our prediction is good for a little while and then becomes essentially worthless rather suddenly at t equals 11. However, we were able to predict farther, so we improved our measurement, and we can predict now until around t equals 11 before it was just t equals 5. So let's try a really, really good measurement. So suppose that we use this, 15.0000001, when in reality it's 15.0. So this is amazingly close to the true value. And sure enough, reality and prediction. Blue is still prediction, red is still reality. March together, right along, for farther now, we can go until almost 18. And yet, then again, as before, the reality, that's the red curve, diverges from the blue curve, and then they become very different after this. So we have a very good measurement, and we can extend our prediction now all the way out to 18. But after 18, our prediction becomes more or less worthless. So I want to stop for a second and just think about the magnitudes of these numbers. And this will help illustrate just what's going on in the butterfly effect. So let's say that x was measuring length. And whatever x is measuring, the same story will hold, but it'll be most concrete if we talk about length. So 15 meters, that's really tall. That's about as tall as a five-story building. But what about this, 0.0000001? So that's about 10 nanometers. 10 times 10 to the minus 9 meters. So that's really small. That's smaller, that's about 1,000 times smaller than a single red blood cell. It's about 10 times larger than a single glucose molecule. So this says that if we have something that's 15 meters, or 15 meters plus 10 glucose molecules, that the behavior will be completely different after just 18 time steps. So on the one hand, this is a deterministic system, just like the differential equations we studied in the last unit. But it depends so much on the initial condition that that determinism almost becomes meaningless. I would say that as a practical matter, the difference between 15.0 and 15 point all of these and then this one isn't just one of not having good enough measuring instruments. It's almost hard to think physically what the difference, you know, what the mean, how to think differently about what these numbers would mean. In a physical or practical sense, it seems they have to mean the same thing. A five-story building, it expands or contracts much, much, much more than this, probably every minute or certainly every day. All sorts of quantities fluctuate naturally. And so if the future depends this much on the initial condition, it's a different sort of determinism, perhaps, than Laplace imagined. So again, to summarize this portion of the lecture, this is an example of the butterfly effect. So a very, very small error in the initial condition grows extremely rapidly. So that means that long-term prediction is impossible. The butterfly effect will eventually win. All small errors are magnified. They're going to grow. And so what we have here is a deterministic, i.e. a rule-based system, that's behaving unpredictably. Right? Once we get out past a region of predictability, even though we have a deterministic system, it behaves as if it's unpredictable. And in a sense, where does that unpredictability come from? Well, this is perhaps oversimplifying a little bit, but the predictability of the rule is in a sense so deterministic, it depends so much on the initial condition that it requires impossible accuracy, almost meaningless accuracy, in that initial condition to be able to do prediction. So the predictability or the determinism or the sensitive dependence on initial conditions is what causes unpredictability in systems like this that show the butterfly effect.